TLO, what's poppin'? We are on Kick, KICK.com. We are live, so you can come join us if you want. If not, that's cool. Just leave a like, comment, subscribe, turn on your post notification bells, man. Let's continue to grow the family from Chicago to the UK. This right here, if for some reason you don't come join on Kick, you know what I'm saying? This is where all the highlights and things of that nature will be. We also got a little merch. Matter of fact, I got the merch on. You get me. Nice little plain and simple, you know what I'm saying? We also got Patreon. Patreon, we upload 5 days a week, Monday through Friday. You know, things that we can't watch on YouTube. Let's get into this though, man. Surviving knife crime, the lives ruined by violence. We always hear about knife crime. We always hear about knife crime. We always hear about the people swinging the knives. We never hear about the victims, man. We never hear about the victims and what it's done to them mentally, physically, what it's done to everybody around them. You know what I'm saying? And I think it's important that we know. So the next time you outside messing with people who are not involved, now you got something to think about. What y'all call them? Civilians? Leave civilians alone. They got nothing to do with nothing. Let's get into this, man. This is from Channel 4 News.
Wakes. The house wakes to the clicks and clacks of long-term care.
Nurse Lisa. Yeah, this is where it's like a massive responsibility because it's getting your dosage and everything right.
Oh, no, we don't.
Morning.
There's no time to ease into the day.
I'm going to do meds, okay?
James Basco-Smith is one of a handful of people in London who has survived a deadly knife injury.
It's just cold.
On Tuesday, the 23rd of February.
Yo.
Last year.
We don't call them, at least in Chicago, we don't call them civilians. We call them neutrons. Like neutral. Neutrons, that's what we call them.
James left his mum on the doorstep for a few minutes. He was test riding a new bike. In that time, he was run over, then stabbed repeatedly. An innocent victim caught between two rival gangs. Suddenly, a young boy into gymnastics and his DJ decks was having his chest opened by medics on the street.
Feeding tube?
His two attackers.
They had to crack his chest in the middle of the street? No way.
Been sentenced to life in prison. The judge said Taquane Lewis and Leon Rashid had been searching for a target to murder. The attack triggered by a drill music video and online provocation between the gangs.
James was in court today, but he gave his impact statement through a video message. I did not deserve this, he told the court. I just want to know why they did this to me. His attackers watched from the dock.
There's somebody outside that door with him 24/7.
I ain't gonna lie to you, they did dirt with bogus. I'm talking, they went above and beyond the call of gangsterism. At some point, like, every time that's gonna catch up with you. I don't condone it, man. Like I said, man, leave innocent people alone. Why are you going to attack an innocent person when there's real ops out here that you could be? You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't understand.
I first met the family on the helipad of King's College Hospital exactly 1 week after the stabbing.
I had a FaceTime from him with him on the floor, like, telling me, Mum, I've been stabbed.
Yes, we have got justice. It still doesn't change the position James is in. It doesn't change the lifestyle that we're now having to live.
This is James's journey. And the story of his family and friends. They too are the victims of violence.
James, what do you think about when you think of the future?
Five knives were found on the road where James was attacked. His liver was lacerated and his lung was punctured. He lost a significant amount of blood, which led to brain damage.
So at the early stages,
I was wondering, like, how did this happen? But you lost a significant amount of blood. Okay.
We had family counseling when this first happened, and it was a huge help.
But the help wasn't accessible. Lisa's sister happened to know a counsellor, and moving to a specially adapted house was a struggle.
Up to this point, we still kind of feel like we've been hard done by, because it's everything that we want to do, we're having to fight for it. Oh gosh, we had...
That's messed up, bro. The before and after is messed up.
Everything that we want to do, we're having to fight for it. Oh gosh, we had such a rough move with housing. It was very much just like, well, we can't help you. And we was trying to explain to them, but if we was a member of a gang and we had to flee our current area, the council or whoever it was would pick us up and move us out.
That's true. I heard about that for their safety, because they got, what's the thing called where they give you that paper where they say somebody's after you?
Borough, quite easily. But instead, for us, it was because we weren't a gang member, there weren't no right channels that the council had to follow in order to get us to move.
One, two, three, four.
Five.
Yeah.
And yet life had to move quickly for everyone. There's Maddie, who's eager to help her cousin James, but grapples with the realities of violence in the community. She's five.
Currently, Madison's in therapy because of the impact. A few months after this happened, we was at home getting ready for church, and Maddie said, Mum, there's people outside, they're screaming and shouting, and there was an incident, and she said, they're gonna come and kill me, I don't wanna go outside.
We sent Freedom of Information requests to the 29 major trauma units in the UK, asking for figures on the numbers of 16 to 25 year olds left with life-changing injuries from a weapon. We found the data on life-changing injuries difficult to access, and it's acknowledged that when numbers are being tracked, there's no uniformity within the system. So for example, at what age do you stop being a young person? That changes from one organisation to the next. So it's little wonder that families are struggling to access mental health support or, say, housing support, when the system doesn't measure what it needs.
I know in Chicago we had victims' crime unit. So if you're a victim of a crime, they made everything very, very easy and accessible for you.
To provide.
We very seldom focus on the actual survivors. When you're a survivor from this type of extreme trauma, you survive with consequences.
Duncan Bew was James's surgeon.
I think there was better visibility in life-changing injuries. I think it could make a real impact in terms of services, to be able to wrap around patients, to provide a continuum of support, and not just focus on those early days when they first present with trauma. When we look at the patients that we saw during the COVID period, we had about a 40% reduction in trauma victims coming through the hospital during that period, but then we're now back up to pre-pandemic levels.
James's teenage sanctuary can also feel lonely at times.
How often do you speak to your friends? Do they ring?
Not as often as you would like, eh?
I know James has had a couple of close friends which, you know, they've dropped out of college. The younger ones, I think, we definitely need to look out for them a lot more and, you know, work with them, see what things we can put in place. Because I think they just...
What's going on,
There are times when a gloom descends on the family, triggered by money worries or flashbacks. But Lisa says over...
He fresh, though. Well, he put that shit on, though, didn't he?
For all, they're the lucky ones, because this support and encouragement is without price.
Rhea Chatterjee there with James's story. Now, it's estimated that more than 200,000 children in England between the ages of 11 and 17 are vulnerable to serious violence. Today, a report from the Commission on Young Lives says a combination of COVID, the rising cost of living, and a possible return to austerity is a gift to those who exploit children. It says the crisis of teenage violence requires some immediate changes, including monthly Cobra-style government meetings, a new Sure Start programme for teenagers, and the extension of free school meals to all families receiving universal credit. Well, Anne Longfield, who chairs the commission, is with me, and I'm also joined by Amani Simpson, who works alongside her and runs a social enterprise, Aveyard Inspires, to empower young people, and he also survived a stabbing attack. Thank you to both of you for coming in. For anyone who needs to understand the impact of the violence you're talking about today, it is written in a terrible way through James's story.
It is, you completely. Know,
he told the court, I did not deserve this. It is hard to live like this.
Mm.
There are other Jameses. There are children who are killed.
Mm.
What needs to be done?
How serious
is it?
Yeah, this is devastating to those individuals, their families, their communities. And it's something that it's in front of us in plain view, but no one's looking, in my view. There are, of course, interventions. There are people doing fantastic work. There are great local organisations. They're living hand-to-mouth often with short-term money without getting that support. And nationally, we do some things to alleviate some of this, but it's all sticking plaster stuff. We need to really commit to get to the bottom.
I don't really like this part of any show, man, because they be talking, and nothing be happening, really. I'd be tired of hearing talking. You know what I'm saying? Get something done. You know what I'm saying? We're never going to stop violence, but at the end of it, there's victims that need to be helped and everything else needs to be in place and it needs to be smooth. Why is that an issue? You know why it's an issue probably somewhere along that line? It's a money issue somewhere. Somebody's greedy. Somebody doesn't want to put that much money in. Like, come on, bro. I ain't trying to be hearing this, man. I'm going to listen to it.
Some of these social problems and really help prevent this happening, which is why we're putting forward these plans today, which will help make that happen.
But the report suggests that there...
Did y'all hear me? Was I muted? No, I wasn't muted. Okay, no, I wasn't muted. Okay. Okay, cool.
There are children who are known to the authorities, who are known to be vulnerable, and yet they're being ignored. I mean, Amani, what's your experience?
First and foremost, I think it's heartbreaking, that video. My heart goes out to James and his family as a survivor of knife crime who has been able to turn my life around and live a particular standard of life. It breaks my heart to watch that. And you're right. There's lots of young people that are known to the system and unfortunately still getting groomed. And that's why we put these recommendations forward, because we don't want that to continue fundamentally. There's so many different services, and a lot of the time they're not speaking to each other. They're not wrapping around this young person and their family. And we need to make sure that, you know, systemic changes are put in place that are sustainable.
And often not offering practical support.
Yeah.
I mean, we heard of cases where, you know, there was a young person with maybe 20 or even 30 professionals around them, but still they weren't getting that practical help. And there would be the meetings going on about their welfare, but at the same time they were suffering at risk of awful consequences. Yeah. It's as if no one understands who is responsible for actually protecting these children and keeping them safe from harm. And that's part of what we need to resolve.
I mean, reading your report, going to any court case involving children and young people who have been involved in violence or who've carried out violence, you'll very often hear both victim and perpetrator are both known to have had problems at school, maybe to have been excluded at school. People know they are struggling, and yet nothing is done until there is a terrible tragedy. Where is it going wrong?
Well, I think that the will needs to be there to resolve this. I don't think there is an acknowledgement of the magnitude of this and the impact of this, which is why I think we need to
That's a fact. The will does need to be there. A lot of people don't. This stuff don't affect them. Like a lot of people that are in charge doesn't affect them. Doesn't affect anybody around them. Don't know what it's really like outside. They put up silver spoon. I don't want to say silver spoon, but like their parents were there to protect them and shield them for a lot of stuff. they weren't born into a lot of things. You know what I'm saying? They'll never know. So it's like, there's that fridge again.
This is a threat to our country. These are 200,000 young people with lives ahead of them. Are we going to stand by and let them come to the most dreadful kind of experiences that we're seeing? So it has to be that level of intervention from the top, from government. It needs better use of money and the engine of government behind it with that will to make a difference. David Cameron did a bit of this with child sexual exploitation. It now needs to be the same with this.
And also, just to add to that as well, a lot of the projects that we're hearing about are not always sustainable. They get funding for a couple of years and you start to kind of build a relationship with a young person, then they pull it out from underneath the legs of the family and the young people. That's unacceptable. You know, when...
Talk about it. And you know when these projects probably be put out? During running years, during election time, during time where, you know, the neighborhood is needed, you know what I'm saying?
Reports like this come out, and ours is, you know, obviously one of a few that have come out before to say this is what needs to happen. When are we going to stop kind of...
I mean, as a young man, you became involved for a little while in County Lines. You ended up being...
I was actually groomed into County
Which
Lines.
Is exactly what the report is talking about.
I was
about.
Groomed.
Children who are vulnerable.
I was in a secure child home, and kind of my relationship and my family had broken down, and someone saw that vulnerability and took advantage. And his actual words to me were, you know, do you want to make some money? And obviously, you know, anyone in here, we say, do you want to make some money? They're going to say yes. I didn't realize what I was getting into. And, you know, I'm blessed that I had a support system when I was ready to kind of take another path that I could lean on. But I feel devastated for the young people that don't have that. And yes, there's mentoring services and things like that. But, you know, there's so much more that needs to happen on a systemic level for these young people.
And it's critical, isn't it, when Armani says, you know, someone says to him, do you want to make some money?
Yeah.
People scoff at the idea sometimes that poverty is part of the problem or that the cost of living crisis might be exacerbating this. But what did you find?
But it's very real, you know, the lure of that. But also now kids knowing that their families have very little, sometimes nothing, they feel that responsibility themselves for bringing money into the household. So we need to fight back. I mean, one of the things we're saying is actually have an army of youth practitioners to be the ones that are on the lookout for these kids as well, to be able to support them. But again, with all of these things, it takes will and it's political choice.
Yeah. And also,
Ghost OTF, that's a fact, man. That's a fact. When you grow up around all of this stuff, you do know what's going on, even if you were a kid. I don't like the word grooming either. It's another word that need to be came up with. But I get what they're saying, but like,
so at the moment, sorry to cut across you, but at the moment, you know, this raft of recommendations costs money. I mean, do you hear the government saying at this particular point, yes, we'll make these kids a priority?
No,
not in any way. But I would say we're spending billions at the moment when things go wrong.
Yeah.
This is about spending it better in a different way to not only prevent crisis, but also to help these young people succeed as citizens in this country.
Yeah, and one of the key things from the report that we've highlighted is that actually using the proceeds of crime that are sitting in dormant accounts and, you know, being able to use that as a way to kind of fuel this army of Rome.
Using the proceeds of crime that are sitting in dormant accounts. Allegedly sitting, not being used already.
Models for young people, to me, that feels like a no-brainer. It doesn't take too much to arrange that, right, in the sense of kind of accessing that and putting the right things in place, and obviously allowing like an administration of national charities to get around this initiative. Because to me, you know, when I speak about my own personal experience, it was a youth worker or it was a teacher or a mentor that looked like me, that understood my perspective, that gave me hope. He spoke to me, you know, I've got a teacher that said to me, look, I don't care what you've done prior to walking into my classroom. From this moment forward, I'm only going to talk about your future and try and help you to get there. And we need more of that for young people.
No cap. Talk about it, man. I went to a high school that did not understand me one bit. They couldn't even walk a mile in a teenager's shoe. So it was really hard for me in high school. But, you know, it is what it is, man. TLO, leave a like, comment, subscribe, turn on your post, man. I'm gone.